Welcome to Hindu Analysis, July 27, 2018. So today we are going to see all these topics. So this topic is coming under GES2, International Relationship. Okay. The first article is AI superpower or client nation. So what this article suggests is whether India is going to be an AI superpower or just a client nation for other countries in receiving these AI technologies. So this is what we are going to discuss today in this article. So what this article says is, so the industrial revolution which was taken place before in the world, what it did is it actually transferred the physical power of the human to machines. That means whatever actions or whatever activities performed by the human beings was then transferred to the machines. But now it is taken to the next level. That means only the physical activities of the human beings is repeated or replicated by the machines before, but now what they are trying to do is the cognitive ability or the intelligence which is possessed by the human beings is also trying to be integrated in those machines. So that is what artificial intelligence means. So if you see two famous persons, what they said about this artificial intelligence, Stephen Hawking feared that this AI could end the humanity itself, and Vladimir Putin, who is the Russian president, he also claims that whoever rules AI will rule the world. So now we are going to see what this AI, which is the artificial intelligence, is. So it is a capability of the machine to imitate the human behavior, or it is the intelligence of the machine to imitate the human behavior. So it is not like we are going to the laboratories and created something and make use of that in the business or application in the business. It is not like that. It is like these artificial intelligence are developed within the businesses and on a day-to-day basis, which means the data which are mined from the businesses in digital platforms, they are making use of those data, and these data are again make use into turn into intelligence, and then again they produce large data. So this cycle is an infinite loop which produces larger data, which is the basis for this artificial intelligence. So any country's artificial intelligence largely exists within its huge domestically owned commercial digital data system. So as we said, data, they are the basis for the artificial intelligence, right? So any country's artificial intelligence depends on that. For example, if you see in case of US, Google, Amazon, Facebook, Microsoft, everything, they all are data driven platforms. Similarly, in China, Baidu, Alibaba and Tencent, everything depends on the data. So they are making use of this artificial intelligence to perform better in their day-to-day activities. But if you see the same thing in case of India, India doesn't have such a large domestically owned commercial data system, which means we do not have anything at all. We have Flipkart before. It is an Indian e-commerce platform, which is a Bangalore based company. So this Flipkart is also a data driven platform. But now what happened is Walmart, which is an American company, it acquired 77% stake in Flipkart. So which indicates that the consumer preferences data or the Indian economy data, whatever which is being procured before by the Flipkart, is now open to those Walmart, which is an American company, which means our data is going to the American economy. So you know, right? So it is obviously going to affect our privacy, which is a future concern. So what the major concern here is, the Indian IT industry leaders generally claims that India is doing well with artificial intelligence, but that is not the real scenario. So that is what this article suggests. That means we are not that much par with other leading countries which are leveraging this artificial intelligence. So now India is trying to find a place in the huge global ecosystem. So what is this huge global ecosystem? In the sense, the artificial intelligence is spreading all over the country. Majorly the global digital corporation, they are taking care of the core functions of the artificial intelligence, and the startup companies are taking care of the peripheral functions. So India now want to enter into this global ecosystem in order to leverage this artificial intelligence for its own use. But what the major concern here is whether India is going to be a superpower in this global ecosystem or a client nation. That means we are going to purchase something regarding this artificial intelligence from other companies or from the foreign companies. So this is what the major concern. Why? Because we know India as a big nation, we don't want to be a client to this artificial intelligence from other companies. We don't want to be a client for other companies. At the same time, we also don't want to outsource our research and development data to other companies or to other foreign companies. So what really counts here is India itself, it has to make use of that data which is available, or it has to control the commercial data ecosystem whichever available in India, and we have to leverage this artificial intelligence in a better way. So technology should flow freely across the globe. It is true. That means we should allow other foreign companies to come to India and invest in India, at the same time to help India in case of leveraging this artificial intelligence. But technology is universal. Technology is global. But at the same time, the data that is available within the country, it is not global. It is local. So we have to treat those data, our country's data, as a national strategic asset. So we have to make use of the data in all sectors such as e-commerce, agriculture, health, education, every data that is available within the country should be make use of by our Indian companies. So that is what they proposed in this article. So why India, in the sense, why we want to make India as a superpower in this artificial intelligence, in the sense, India has a huge market base, first of all, and India is a huge superpower already in IT, as well as India has a huge entrepreneurial competence as well as the managerial competence. So we have to make use of that in order to make India as a AI superpower. The next article is tackling HIV. India has brought down its HIV, but there is still, it need to do more in order to reduce the social stigma. So what this article suggests is the progress is there. That means reduction of HIV is there in our country, but it is not been fast enough. So we have to speed up the process in order to reduce the HIV which is spreading in our country. So it should be changed from political commitment to strong actions. It should not be just a law, it should be implemented successfully. That is what they want to say in this article. So 20 years ago, if a person is getting affected with HIV, and an average, he will live up to 12 years. But today, the HIV affected persons are living nearly a normal lifespan with uninterrupted treatment if provided to that person. So this is what the development in our country. So if you see, in 2010 to 2017, there is a rapid progress in reducing this HIV. That means there is a great reduction in the number of HIV patients in the country. And also the administration of this antiretroviral therapy to the patients is also taking place in a good way, which means 3 out of 4 people with HIV now know their status, and 21.7 million people get the treatment properly. So this is what the recent UNAIDS report states. Okay. And also what they suggest here is there is a largest reduction in the incidence of HIV, particularly in Eastern and Southern Africa, as well as in Asia, including India. So India has brought down the new cases of HIV incidence by 27%, as well as the deaths of HIV patients by 56%. So it is a good progress, as well as tuberculosis, which is the biggest killer of the HIV patients. That is also what they are telling here, is 90% of the notified tuberculosis patients able to get the treatment properly. So the social stigma towards the AIDS infected people is also declining slowly, which means before, the people who are getting affected by HIV are living in a very fragile condition, which means they are constantly undergoing some kind of discrimination, inequality, instability in their living condition. But now it is declining rapidly in the country. So even though we are achieving all these things, still India is among the largest HIV burden countries in the world. So the Immoral Traffic Prevention Act, which is criminalizes the several aspects of sex workers, as well as Section 377 of IPC, which criminalizes the homosexual, which is against the nature. So these are all indicates that the law itself makes the stigma legitimize. If we see in case of men who have sex with other men, or people who inject drugs, as well as the sex workers, if these people are affected with HIV, they should come for the treatment, right? But they are not now coming for the treatment. Why? Because the fear of prosecution under these two laws make them to stay away from the treatment. So we all know about the SDG, which is the Sustainable Development Goal, which has 17 goals, right? So the third goal in that SDG is to combat these kind of diseases and to promote the well-being of the people, which means to combat the tuberculosis, malaria, combat the vector-borne diseases, as well as the communicable diseases. So all these are under the target 3. So if we go deep into that, then we are having that the UN's program is aiming at 90-90-90. So which is, if you see here, 90% of the people who are living with the HIV should know that they actually have HIV. So they should know the status. So among the people who know the status that they have HIV, among them 90% of the people should receive this antiretroviral therapy. And among the people who are receiving this antiretroviral therapy, 90% should have the viral suppression, which means the amount of virus in the HIV positive person's blood should be reduced. So this is what the aim of the UN's SDG goal, target 3.3. But if we see the recent report, it is like this, 41, 52, 83. You understand, right? That means 41 is know their status and 52% of them are only getting antiretroviral therapy and 83% of them are only having the viral suppression. So this is troubling. So we have to speed up the process in order to reduce the HIV incidence. What this article also suggests here is we have to take Karnataka government as an example because they recently took an initiative where the advocacy work for the senior police officials, that means a lot of sensitization workshops as well as the inclusion of the HIV and the human right topics in the pre-service curriculum to those police officials would enhance their knowledge towards the HIV affected people, as well as there is a further reduction in the arrest of the sex workers. So this is a good initiative. So this is a good initiative by Karnataka government. So we should draw some inspiration from this initiative and we make use of that in our further policies. So ending HIV by 2030 is not ambitious, it is achievable, because in Cuba, the reduction in the transmission of mother to child HIV transmission as well as syphilis transmission is completely reduced, which indicates that ambitious target can also be achieved. So we have to get the inspiration from that and we have to draw the further policies on the basis of that. So the next topic is Lok Sabha passes anti-trafficking bill. So the Trafficking of Persons Bill 2018 aims at preventing the human trafficking, especially of women and children, as well as it wants to rehabilitate the victims who are affected by means of this trafficking, as well as to prosecute the offenders who are involving in this trafficking. So what are the proposals under this bill, if we see, means it actually aims at establishing an dedicated institutional mechanism, which is NATB, which is a National Anti-Trafficking Bureau. So what is its aim is to coordinate, monitor as well as surveillance of these trafficking cases whichever happening in our country. And also the proposal of this bill is relief and rehabilitation committee establishment in district level, state level as well as in the national level. So rehabilitation fund is also has to be created. So if at all a person is getting involved in this trafficking, then the forfeiture or the seizing of the property of the person is also be mentioned in this bill. So it is a victim-centric bill or it is a gender-neutral bill. So that is what the main thing here is. So the bill was not intended to harass the sex workers. It is to protect them actually. The government was not against the victims. It is actually against the trafficking. So we all know that under the bill, they actually provide some provisions like for trafficking, 7 to 10 years of imprisonment, and for aggravated form of trafficking 10 years to life imprisonment. So these are all the provisions or the punishments which is given for the traffickers. What they are aiming here is the government is telling every state government to establish some state nodal officers to follow up the actions which are taking under this NATB. Also what they are aiming is the rehabilitation fund that is provided should be used for the well-being, that is the psychological, physical as well as the social well-being of the victims, as well as to provide them some basic educational health care as well as the safe accommodation facilities for the victims who are getting affected by means of this trafficking. So the next topic is endangered elephant shot dead. So the elephant which was shot dead was the pygmy elephant on Borneo Island. So why? Because it was destroying the crops. So for a revenge, they actually killed that elephant. So this is the Borneo Island. So there only this incident took place. For the prelims perspective, the pygmy elephant lives in both Africa as well as in Asia. So it inhabiting the tropical rainforest in the northern Borneo as of now. If we see the habitat of this pygmy elephant, which is this rainforest clad Borneo, so this is a world's third largest island and is shared between Malaysia, Brunei as well as Indonesia. So the IUCN status of this pygmy elephant is endangered. So the next article is new Alzheimer's drug shows early promise. So what is Alzheimer's is? So it is a disease which actually affects the memory or destroys the normal mental functions, which means in the long run, it is going to result in the memory loss. So Alzheimer's is memory loss. But as of now, there is no effective treatment for Alzheimer's. So 44 million people worldwide is getting affected with this memory loss, and also it will get triple by 2015. So this is a major concern. So if we see this, how this Alzheimer affects us in the sense, So it is an accumulation of this amyloid protein in the brain, which means this amyloid protein, which is normally produced by the body, our body generates this amyloid proteins. So this amyloid protein, right? So it is naturally producing by our body. So this amyloid protein, right? So this is actually going to get accumulated in the long run. So in our brain, if this amyloid protein in an unnatural way, that means the abnormal level of accumulation of this amyloid protein in the brain could lead to the memory loss, which means so the nerve cells or the neurons in the brain is now getting accumulated with this amyloid protein. So on the long run, it will affect the memory and it disrupts the normal cell functions of the brain, which obviously could lead to the memory loss of the patients. So as of now, we don't have that much remedy or that much solution for this Alzheimer, but now a Japan-based company, it developed a drug which is called BAN2401. So this drug, for the first time in a large clinical trial, it is a little bit successful, which means it is now in the phase 2. Only if it passed the phase 3, then only it is surely climbed to be a successful one, but now it is in phase 2, it is successful. So this drug was able to reduce both the plaques in the brains of the patient, as well as it slows the progress of the dementia. So the other drugs which we used before, right, so that only helps in one way, which means it reduces the amyloid levels which is segregated or which is accumulated in the brain, but it doesn't ease the memory decline. It is not helping in this perspective. It is only reducing this amyloid level. So this BAN2401 helps in both perspective. It reduces the amyloid levels in the brain as well as it slowed the cognitive decline. So it is a very good improvement. If it passed the phase 3, it will be a very good treatment for the Alzheimer patients in the long run. So the next article is Kargil Vijay Diwas. So the president, vice president and the prime minister are paying homage to the martyrs of the Kargil on 19th Kargil Vijay Diwas. So recently this 19th Kargil Vijay Diwas was commemorated. So it is to actually commemorate the victory of Indian forces over the Pakistan in the hills of Kargil. So it is also indicating the success of Indian Operation Vijay in 1999. So it also acknowledges the efforts as well as the gallantry of our armed forces which was exhibited during the Kargil war. So the last article is the Pakistan test. Yesterday, the former cricketer Imran Khan's party won in the general election. That is, he is now emerged as a prime minister of Pakistan. So this result or the victory of Imran Khan is tainted now by a lot of allegations of rigging as well as the military interference. So now there are a lot of challenges in front of him. So how he is going to face all those challenges? That is what this article suggests. The first one is economy BOP, which means there is a balance of payment crisis in Pakistan. So how he is going to face that? So that is one major question in front of him. So the second one is how he is going to approach the Taliban issue which is prevailing in Pakistan. So the next concern is engagement with India. That is how he is going to engage his relationship with India. That is also a major concern because the relationship between India and Pakistan is not fruitful. There are also the ceasefire violations which is taken place at the border. There is always an unending Kashmir issue is going on between India and Pakistan. So how he is going to approach the engagement with India, that is also a major concern. So the next major concern is dealing with US. Recently, US criticized Pakistan that they are providing soil for terrorism. Also, they are not taking adequate measures to stop this terrorism. So this is what US criticized about Pakistan. So how he is going to tackle that issue or how he is going to face all these challenges which is in front of Imran Khan. So let's see how he is going to handle all these challenges and overcome.